Welcome along to day two of Profitable Property Secrets Week, and it is based on the updated version of this book by my co-host this week, founder of Platinum Property Partners, Steve Bolton. And Steve, we're so delighted to have PPP powering this week. I know, you know, you've already said in the previous episode what a massive advocate you are of education, and I know that you personally, you're still very, very committed to education yourself, aren't you?
Yeah, learning all the time, reading books. Not as good as Bill Gates, who I think reads about 50 books a month and can read 150 pages an hour. Wow. So I'm not at that kind of level. But yeah, reading books, mentors, coaches, going on courses. I think Warren Buffett says that the best investment you can ever make is an investment in yourself.
Yes.
Your learning, your training, your development. So I'm just going to listen to the best investor the world's ever seen and follow what he does.
Fantastic. Well, for this next instalment, we're calling it... the risk of not protecting your downside. And of course, there are many, many risks in property. Some you can predict, some you can't. Steve, what, in your view, is the biggest risk out there?
The biggest risk, in my view, is an internal risk. So there's internal and external. External outside of your control, internal within your control. It's actually you as a person, you as an individual, the way you think, the decisions you make, the choices you make, how hard you work or don't work, whether you've got education, you don't know what you don't know. That's the reality of it. And I think the most dangerous thing is people that are either ignorant or arrogant. You know, they're ignorant, they don't know what they don't know, and they're not willing to learn, or arrogance where I think I know it all. Mm-hmm. They are, and I've been guilty of both of those things in the past, mm-hmm. and they are the things that have cost me the most time and the most money. Mm-hmm. So ignorance, arrogance, and a lack of education, a lack of understanding about what you're trying to achieve. Also not having the right people around you, you know, professional advisors, educators, all of that sort of stuff. So mm-hmm. It's actually, people think, oh, it's the property market, it's interest rates, it's the government, it's mm-hmm. Brexit, it's politicians. Mm-hmm. No, the biggest risk without question is the individual that's buying the houses and running the business.
No, I can see that. And I guess what I'm taking away from that is that, being committed to education, being open-minded, being willing to listen to perhaps people that don't necessarily share your view, because I've always found that one of the best ways to learn is to listen to people that have a different opinion to me. And then I can kind of test my own opinion against them. And very often I'll think, actually, no, I can see what they're saying. I need to adjust my thinking on that. So I guess, landlords, as I think now more than ever, have to adopt, a business-like approach. And part of that is to constantly keep taking in new inputs.
Yeah, definitely. And especially in this changing environment that we're in, politically, economically, all of that sort of stuff. So, yeah, if you go outside and we look at some of the external risks, what are they? We've been in a relatively low interest rate environment for quite a long period of time. The political risk and the political uncertainty, you look at the impact of Brexit. If you've got a business or if you're buying property abroad, what are going to be the implications of those sorts of things? So I've always advocated try and invest in an area where you live that you know, that you understand. Yeah, don't have a portfolio, ideally, that's spread out all over the country, because then you're bringing in another risk, which is time, and not having local connections. So if you focus in an area, you can get the builders get to know you, tradespeople, estate agents. Mm-hmm. It's just much easier to manage. Whereas if you've got a property in Manchester and Birmingham and Norwich and London, you've got to build up four teams of support in those locations. And then when things go wrong, you've got to travel to those locations. So, so focusing on an area, getting good on a particular strategy, mm-hmm. and doubling down and making sure it's a really good strategy that, as we said in the previous episode, it suits your financial goals, and is aligned to what you understand and what you learn. Because you can't be jack of all trades, master of none is incredibly dangerous in property. Mm-hmm. It really is. So, there's some of the key risks, I think, and some of the ways to mitigate against them.
And if we talk about another external risk, that is government intervention, which we've had a huge amount of in the last 4 or 5 years. Landlords have had an absolute hammering. You yourself founded the Axe the Tenant Tax campaign to try and fight Section 24. Now we've got the potential abolition of Section 21. Landlords just... how can they stay motivated when we are having such a hammering? What do you say to yourself when you hear about these things coming through the pipeline?
I think that it's at one level, outrageous, and that's why with Chris Cooper and your support and many other people's support in the industry, we crowdfunded a campaign to fight, Section 24, and we went all the way to the High Court, lost, unfortunately. But fundamentally, I think we, as an industry, we can kind of fight back. I think it's great that the two largest landlord associations are now coming together. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The RLA and the NLA, and the synergy, we've worked very closely with both of those, as you have as well. So I think that's great for the industry. I think it's really one of the most positive moves that I've seen in a long time, actually. So I'm very hopeful that will give us a united voice. But at an individual level, I don't think it's not a politician's job to motivate you to run your property business.
No, sure.
Right. So actually, it's almost like forget that. They're going to cause chaos. They'll continue to cause chaos. It's we're in a time of incredible political uncertainty. But actually, focusing on what you're doing, and I think there's two situations here. You've got people that have built a property business. Mm. On certain assumptions, mm-hmm. And that's why I was so angered, really, and Chris was, and you were, and everybody was about Section 24, because we built portfolios, or people built a business based on a certain set of assumptions, and all of a sudden, George Osborne ripped the carpet out and said, no, we're going to change the tax rules, not from now moving forward, like they do with most things, but actually in a retrospective manner. That for me was what was outrageous, because you got people like Chris, who'd built, worked hard for British Airways, paid into a pension, but actually had taken responsibility and taken on the extra workload for building a property portfolio, providing legal, warm, quality homes for people that either didn't want to buy or couldn't afford to buy, and was penalised. It completely destroyed his pension provision, and that's happened to a lot of people. Mm-hmm. Fortunately for us and PPP, we buy in companies, it's a professional investment strategy, so we weren't affected in the same way. But I think that you have to be a professional investor. What happened in 2015 and has continued is the market has gone away, and the political environment has gone away from amateur and accidental landlords that just have a house or have a flat or a couple of properties, stick it with a letting agent, don't really understand what they're doing, and have actually made a lot of money. That's what the government said. No, this is, you either do this properly and professionally, and you provide a good service to the highest possible standards, or you get out the market. Mm. That's fundamentally what they've done. Mm-hmm. And for the people that have left, they want to, make as much tax as they possibly can through stamp duty and other things. Mm. But if you've got a good investment strategy, you can still make money and pay tax and provide a quality product to your tenants as well. Mm. But it's a professional investor's market now, for sure.
No, I totally agree with you. And there's a lot to be, positive about that standards have been raised within the sector and that people are treating it more professionally, because then, again, that does mitigate risk as well. And I guess, we are talking about avoiding the pitfalls, and my number one sort of feeling on that is that the best way to avoid the pitfalls is to become an expert at due diligence. So whether it's due diligence on a prospective tenant, a prospective property, a letting agent, a builder, you've got to do your research. That is the best way to avoid the pitfalls, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. But it's not an easy thing to do. And I think there's always, I've made mistakes. I've sort of been into business with people that I thought, we've had people that I've met that I think, oh, what, such a nice guy. And, you kind of due diligence and all that sort of thing, and then actually 5 years later something comes out the woodwork and you're just like, really? That person did that? So I don't think there is a foolproof way of doing it, but certainly being cautious, asking the difficult questions, You know, finding, as you've got on Property Tribes, you know, people search due diligence, there's loads of tools and, you know, checklists. And in our industry, in franchising, you know, the British Franchise Association have a 60-point due diligence checklist. All the questions to ask your franchisor: can we see audited accounts? Can we meet people that are actually doing this? Can we meet your most successful, your least successful? You know, can I come to your office? Can I meet some of the staff? You know, so spending your time doing that due diligence. In our business, people from first contact to joint normally takes 6 months. You know, doesn't cost them anything, but they've got 6 months on average. It can be shorter or longer to do their due diligence, you know, and it's open book. You want to see accounts? Great, we'll show you accounts. You want to see legal agreements? We'll show you. You want to come to an event and speak to other people? You can come. Want to see somebody in their, you know, so really kick the tires of either a company that's going to provide services to you, or mortgage brokers, or estate agents, or a house that you're going to buy. Just really go deep and take your time. Don't, you know, don't make the mistake of suffering from analysis paralysis. I always remember a guy actually that when I did property talks and things like that, he would come up, and I saw him, I think, first in 2008. He said, "Hi, Steve." And we had a chat, and we had a sort of cup of coffee. And then 2009, "Hi, Steve. Yeah, how are you getting on?" "Oh, yeah, I'm still thinking about it." And, you know, fast forward 2015. "Oh, hi, Steve. How you doing?" It's like, "Yeah, hi, John. How you doing? Yeah, you bought anything yet?" No. Still doing my job. I'm like, that's like 7 years have gone by, right? And they hadn't done anything. So you can do too much analysis or too much diligence and not actually take action. But I think generally people fall into the category you're talking about, where they don't do enough.
Yes, indeed. I know you have a very pragmatic and business-like approach to everything, Steve. I just wondered, do you also listen to kind of your gut instinct? Because I know certainly when it comes to things I've done in property, the few times I didn't listen to my gut instinct, it didn't work out well for me.
Yes. I mean, there's an old saying in terms of decision making that we make decisions based on emotion backed up by logic. Whereas actually, if you talk to most people, and people hear me talk, it's like, he's very kind of logical and serious and, you know, all this kind of, it's facts and numbers and spreadsheet. Actually, no, I mean, the difficulty with gut instinct and emotion, and A, it's hard to quantify, and B, sometimes it can be wrong, you know. So I personally, when it comes to property and business, actually my starting point is normally a spreadsheet. Okay. My starting point is normally facts, data, logic. And then, you know, so then that might give me a short list of 5 houses or 10 houses that on paper, in the numerical sense, look like they're going to achieve my financial objectives. Okay. I then might go to the house and actually view it and look around it, or hotel or whatever it might be. And then you get an instinct of the area and the feel and the, you know, so that's a very important kind of overlay. So I definitely listen to that instinct. So actually having a process and a system for things that you do that are backed up by facts, data and logic, but then listening to that gut instinct and going off that emotional feel. And I think also getting other people's opinions is like super important, because we've got, like, I'm, you know, people say you're really good at choosing franchise partners, at business partners, at people at a senior level, or people that have got an entrepreneurial flair or an investment mindset. I'm really good because that's my mindset. I'm actually really bad at hiring staff that work in, you know, that work in a business, and I have to have other people that support me in doing that because I'm just not very good at it. So I think that self-awareness of knowing what you're good at and what you're not good at, and then bringing in other people that can help you, is really, really important. So if you're not, you know, women generally, not to be sexy, are much more intuitive, you know, as a generalization. So actually it's a good thing for guys, if you're not intuitive, to actually get the advice of women or other people that are more intuitive, you know, and having that balance, because we're not good at everything. Nobody can be.
No, I think that's very, very sound advice. Thank you for that. I just want to wrap this segment up now, Steve, by just saying you said something earlier which really resonated with me, and that is, don't be afraid to ask hard questions. And I will put a link underneath this video to a thread we've got, which is 100 questions that every landlord should know to ask. A point I'd like to make, Steve, is that anybody who has an ethical business and a transparent business isn't going to mind being asked legitimate questions. I think a big red flag is if you ask somebody a completely legitimate question and they become hostile towards you. Mm-hmm. I know at PPP you're very transparent, and we just should mention here actually that you have your discovery days where people can come along and meet your teams and get a feel for the business. You know, people shouldn't be afraid, as you said, to ask those questions, because the way somebody reacts is actually part of that due diligence. Process, sure. Isn't it?
Yeah, it is, absolutely. And I think it's, you know, if I go right back to the beginning of PPP and people say, can I see your accounts? Like, well, yeah, but there's only like one set, which is like my portfolio. So I think you've got to put it in context about, you know, a company that's been going 20 years or 30 years or 50 years or, you know, 12 years in the case of PPP versus somebody that's starting out. For me, that time and consistency, like in the British Franchise Association, you can only achieve full level membership, and there's only about 230 companies in the UK that have achieved that level, if you can prove your accounts that it's profitable, you have a franchise network, and you as a company have been through an economic cycle.
Yeah.
Okay. So when there's been a recession, and actually then you achieve full level of membership. So time, you know, that experience and that time and that credibility, I think is also a good indicator.
It is.
I love learning from people that have lost a business or lost a house or where the proverbials hit the fan and they've come out the other side, because it's like that gives you an appreciation that nothing fails like success. Mm. You know, actually you can be successful, and if you do, as I was, you know, for the first time, and then it all gets taken away from you, you fundamentally change your mindset, your outlook, you become much more humble, you're much more willing to learn, all of those sorts of things, you know. So so checking a company's been around for a long time, has been through an economic cycle, is another a good kind of overlay to the risk management process.
Definitely. I concur 100%. Well, we've reached the end of our second day of this themed week, and tomorrow we're going to be talking about that numbers never lie, and that you can, you know, understand the numbers or not understanding the numbers is the difference between a successful deal or a failed deal. So
the numbers do lie if the person putting in them
if the inputs are wrong. Yes,
yes.
Very good point. So do join myself and Steve again tomorrow as we continue with our themed week of profitable property secrets.